Hey, this will be a discussion about brass embouchure and the differences in embouchure, and how even if you think you might have a bad embouchure, it can be overcome by strengthening your embouchure from all different kinds of directions. And I'm going to play some embouchures that are bad for me, and that typically for me I would not be able to play very well using these type of embouchures. Now, one thing to keep in mind, no one embouchure is really bad for an individual. And so what that really means is what might be bad for me and I sound horrible on might be really good for you. And so it depends on, if you look carefully, your lips, how long they are, how short they are, how narrow they are, how thick they are, how thin they are, your teeth, how much of an overbite you have, how much of an underbite you have, if they're crooked, if you're wearing braces, so if maybe you have a partial denture, so it can include a lot of different things, and also your bone and jaw structure. That's why I think that some brass coaches and teachers can do more harm to a student by forcing them into a particular embouchure. For example, the most common would be centered and a little bit more on the top lip. That seems to be, you know, the most common. But not everybody is going to do well with that particular embouchure. The other thing that you should be aware of is that if you attempt to drastically change your embouchure, it seems like in my experience and opinion, people that have done that end up really not faring any better. In fact, a lot of people get worse. So if you think a big drastic embouchure change is the answer, you're probably barking up the wrong tree. So let's look at some various embouchures. Here we can see. For me, I tend to play a little higher. So I guess you got your high player or high lip placement position. You got your medium or middle and your low. So those would be the different placements. So high would be, it's probably high. Now I can go higher, but that's probably close to where I normally would play. Now what happens if I wasn't playing that way and I was using an embouchure that was bad for me? Let's try something. Let's drop it way down. So I'm up here. Let's go on way down. Way down. Hear the difference in tone quality? But guess what? I'm still able to get the high C. I'm still able to play. But it doesn't sound that good. But I can still do it. Let's go maybe medium. So normally I play here. Let's go down just a little bit. Seemed like it noticeably flat on the high C. I think I was flat on the first one too. But so I'm still able to play. Now I'm gonna be tying this all into a huge point here. Okay, so now let's talk about angles. So I can use my normal embouchure here. What if I bring it up? Because I see people playing like this. Okay, it had a significant high angle to it. One of the most interesting embouchures I've ever seen is by Stan Mark, the famous lead trumpet player for Maynard Ferguson. I don't know how he can play the way he does. Take a look at it. It's like he puts the trumpet up straight, and then he comes up to the mouthpiece. You really got to watch him do it when he's playing live. It's very interesting. He's got the trumpet here, and then he'll come up. So the trumpet's actually straight out, but he's coming up at this angle. So, now, most of the embouchures that I'm showing you are ones that I really couldn't play on. In fact, if I was playing on them, I might be just like you are right now. If you have a particular question about your embouchure and that it's not working for you, well, if my trumpet teacher long ago had said you need to play like this, like Stan Mark, so I got the horn out, I'm cutting into it like this. Well, I mean, if I was using that embouchure all along, thinking that was how it was supposed to be, I would be having a lot of trouble, and I would be wanting to look at a video like this to change my embouchure, or do something about it. So, okay, so now we had the upper angle like that. Did we do this one yet? Well, I think that's kind of like more like Stan Marks, isn't it? Yeah, it's more of a, he's coming into like that, but you can still go downwards. Okay, now what if you don't play center? A lot of us brass teachers want kids to be centered right smack dab in the middle of their lips. Unfortunately, our jaw structure and teeth and everything else might suggest otherwise. So here's me, I'm center now. I'm a little bit off-center, I guess. It's kind of difficult to do this too while I'm playing, but I wanted to get the camera up close, and so I needed to be holding the camera. Okay, so here's kind of where I normally play. What if I didn't play centered? I played off. I can still get it. It's a little bit crackly. What if I go way over? What if I'm crazy and I go way over here? That's a real screwed up embouchure, isn't it? Okay, let me try playing the horn left-handed here and hold the camera this other way. So, go back to center. Or center for me. Let's move it over to the left a little bit. Let's just say I played a little bit off. Okay? That's kind of wacky, isn't it? But some people play in all these different positions. Now, no, I've never seen anybody really play out here. But what if we go over here? I'm going to go crazy. Look at that. All right. So you saw various positions from high to medium to low, mouthpiece placement, and of course each one of those takes a different embouchure to be able to play, right? You saw me go over a little off center, way off center, back to center, off center this way, and way off. And then you saw the horn angles like this, and then down. So I basically covered just about any embouchure that a brass player could play with. Now, the point I'm trying to make in all of this is that there's one reason that I could go up to high C on all those angles, all those embouchures. Now, granted, you notice that the tone quality went way out the window on a lot of them. And obviously, that would mean that I wouldn't use that particular embouchure, right? But how am I able to do that? And if I wanted to, folks, I can switch my embouchure to any embouchure and start to get comfortable and familiar with it and let it sink in. It takes me about a week. And I'm able to do all that because of an extreme amount of strength that I build up in the embouchure and the lips. So what is my real point to you brass players out there that are micromanaging yourself, that are being confused by too much worry and thinking, what's that analysis by paralysis kind of thing, overanalyzing everything? So my advice to you is, number one, you need to do something that will hit your embouchure from so many different directions that it almost won't even matter what embouchure that you use. I mean, you want to use the embouchure where you feel most comfortable, where you get the best sound, the best tone, and things just feel right. You don't want to use the embouchure that a teacher tells you to use and it feels horrible. It always seems bad. It seems like you're always struggling. Of course, you don't have any high range and your endurance is shot. But supposedly, quote unquote, that's the place where you should put it. Ideally, I like to have my students, my younger ones, start off with centered on the lips and slightly a little higher on your top lip. But sometimes that doesn't work for them, you know, depending on what I see going on with them and, you know, their teeth structure and other things in their lips. Sometimes we have to bring it back right down to the center, and sometimes even go down a little bit lower. Sometimes the upstream player will not be an upstream player until he or she or their teacher figures that out. So if a student is not doing too well with the typical embouchure that I like to get them started on, well, I'll start playing with it. We might move their mouthpiece down and have more of the lower lip inside the cup. And if they do a lot better with that, then hey, why not? That's them. Why not let them do that? So you need to strengthen your chops, your embouchure, and your lips in many different directions. So what did we learn? We learned that not one particular embouchure is suited for everybody. And you may find that playing on embouchure that supposedly does not look good to other players, but works for you, that may be the embouchure that you need to be using. You got to play where it's comfortable, where you're sounding good, and if you're a little bit off center, and if the horn angle, like for Stan Mark, look, you got to Google him and watch him play. I mean, he's got an extreme angle that he's coming at. I don't know how he does it, but it works for him. And there's other people that play with the horn at an extreme up angle, and then there's people that play off the side of the center of their lips. So you got to find the sweet spot for you, not the sweet spot that your teacher thinks is for you. If the teacher thinks of a great embouchure position for you when you were younger and it worked, by all means, that teacher gave you great advice. If the teacher kept forcing you to stay in with a particular setup, but you are not doing that well, that's when you really need to start thinking differently. And maybe there might be a different setup. For people, in fact, I want to thank Sharon for giving me an idea about this particular video. So for people who are concerned about bad embouchures and good embouchures, more mouthpiece pressure, less mouthpiece pressure, I really don't want you to be thinking about that if you're working with me and you're taking lessons from me or you're taking my course. What I want you to be doing is focusing on the 75 techniques, if you're involved in my course, that are going to hit this from so many different angles. In fact, now is a perfect time to plug my course, which you know I almost do in almost all my videos. Your embouchure and the muscles here in your lips need to be worked in so many different directions. And you know what that really does is it makes worrying about embouchure and everything else, angles and where your mouthpiece is hitting your lips, too high, too low, in the middle, off center, almost irrelevant. Because once you develop chops of steel, you can pretty much play anywhere that you wanted. I demonstrated that, right? I mean, I took the angles all over my mouth, and I was still able to get up to high C. You just probably heard a change in tone quality from either decent to bad. But still, I was able to do it, mainly because of this. So you need, if you're concerned about your embouchure, lack of strength, or maybe you're using a bad embouchure, you're using excessive pressure, there's really only one answer, and you're going to have to come to the conclusion quickly by deferring to someone that knows what they're doing and has worked with a lot of people. That would be like me or somebody else in my capacity. Or you can kind of go to the school of hard knocks and keep pounding away at the one method that you're using. Maybe you're not even using a method. Maybe you're just practicing all technique, Clark and Arvin's and other stuff and some warm-ups. Or maybe you are involved in a routine, Claude Gordon, only doing Claude Gordon, or only doing the palming method with William Costello and Roy Stevens, or only doing the isometric stuff of Carmine Caruso. So if you're pounding away at one routine and you don't want to change, yet you have embouchure problems, endurance problems, range problems, excessive mouthpiece pressure problems, and it doesn't matter if you're on trumpet or trombone or euphonium or French horn or any brass instrument, the mechanics and the approach is still the same, basically. Well, you're going to find out through the school of hard knocks, if you keep insisting on working that one routine for your embouchure development, you're going to find out it doesn't work. It only takes you to a certain amount and you get stuck. So my advice is to go back and rewind this video and watch it again and think to yourself, how is he able to put that mouthpiece in all these wacky positions on his lip, up and down and all around, yet still be able to get a high C out on each one? If the answer comes to you that maybe I might have stumbled onto something that's very successful when it comes to embouchure development, then you really need to look in the item description below this video and go to my homepage, trumpetsizzle.com. And I'm mainly addressing people that have embouchure problems, that have problems with too much mouthpiece pressure, that maybe play off to the side or too high or too low, or maybe need to experiment. The 75 techniques in my course almost is an auto correction mechanism for minor embouchure problems. In other words, it's hard to go through all 75 techniques and get those down after 4 months and not have had some kind of shift in your embouchure. Your embouchure and your mouthpiece placement will shift during the 4 months. For some, slightly, and for some, noticeably, because you'll need to be able to accommodate those various techniques. And you just can't go through 75 different techniques in 4 months and not have a change take place here. You're going to have the musculature thicken and develop, but you're also going to have a change take place in the embouchure. So, if you don't recognize me by my lips, I'm Kurt Thompson. You may have thought this was somebody else the whole time, but I am Kurt Thompson, and I wanted you to get a close-up of my jaw, my lips, and hopefully got close enough on those different embouchures. So don't let embouchure scare you or wear you down. You focus instead on building embouchure strength from all kinds of angles, and from my point of view, 75 techniques with the different angles that we're going to hit you at in your embouchure is just the holy grail to upper register and endurance improvement. Well, now that you got to know my lips really good and my embouchure, I'll see you in the next one. Take care. Bye-bye.